These yours?
They are, thank you. We'll be starting in just a minute. Let folks know.
This is Matt and Cheese, let me be right. I'm just trying to get your graduation and everything. Yeah, they gotta give me.
Not so much.
Okay.
I think you'll need yours around.
No, I'm gonna have to make sure to go to the test with me, so I'm gonna make sure this out. And she's just gonna fall in love with the family.
Would you have been in that too? They're on.
The food is.
All I heard Jackson was Carol. I get the radar.
He's supposed to wait until the second.
No, it doesn't work that way with them, yeah. Anybody can vote for seconds. All right, if we can get it, if I can get everybody's attention, we'll go ahead and get going. I really appreciate y'all coming out tonight. It's interesting, you know, we'd set this meeting up and then I got an email from our person who's handling our trip at EF saying, it's about time for you to have a meeting. And so we've kind of gone through all this and he sent me this really good list. You know, I was kind of putting the agenda together for tonight about things to talk about. And he sent me a really good list, some of which, I don't know if you had a chance to look at the agenda for tonight, but a lot of that I ended up kind of linking to our agenda. So there's a lot of information. And I won't keep you real long, but there are several things that I thought were really important. You know, with 4 weeks to go, now less than 4 weeks to go, it's pretty critical that we start making sure some things are in place. And I'm happy to say, I think from what I've heard from EF, everything's in place as far as logistics and passports and all of that kind of stuff. So we're good and we're happy about that. But, you know, now it's like just making sure we're ready to get on the plane and actually go to the other side of the planet. And I don't know about y'all, but for me as the trip leader, you know, thinking about that and thinking about some of the responsibilities that go along with that, I was like, I want to make sure I cover some bases before we actually get to that point. I also want to give y'all a chance to ask some questions. So I'm going to go through some information. We're broadcasting for the people that can't be here. And if you have anybody in your family that couldn't make it, please make sure that they watch this broadcast and go over this information. One of the things that's going to happen after this meeting is I'm going to be sending out a checklist that I will ask to get back prior to the trip, along with some of your documents. One of the things that I'm going to need to do is to keep copies of your passports, and I'll get into passport stuff in a little bit. But one of the things that happens is often we are in places where, like we're at the hotel, usually we hand over our passports at that point, they stay at the hotel. So we want to have documentation, we want to have that kind of stuff with us while we're out and about. I like to have, I want to be able to be sure that I have copies in case something happens where we need that. So first off, before we get into nuts and bolts, I'd love to start with introductions. And I think we've done a little bit of this, but particularly from for parents and those who are here as supporters, we just need to know who you are. For those of you that are going on the trip, make sure that let us know that you're going on the trip. So please introduce yourself and then tell us one thing that those of us who will be spending 8 days on the other side of the planet with you should know about you. Just something, what is something that people who are traveling with you should know about you? So I'm going to put Mr. Reynolds and Ms. Wilson on the spot. For those of you that don't know, Jerry Reynolds and Dustin have different roles with Blue Ridge Governor School. Mr. Reynolds is our computer science instructor and online coordinator, and Ms. Wilson is our computer science supervisor and senior advisor at Madison. So we've got a lot of Blue Ridge covered. So they will be the official chaperones along the trip. So Mr. Reynolds, I'm going to go ahead and start with you. One thing that anybody that's traveling with you should know about you.
Are you scared that I'm going to be with you?
Yeah. A lot of people don't think you're real. They think
you're
he's just on servers.
Yeah, exactly. So.
I'll
be over there. No, I'm really looking forward to this, and I love it. I love to experience their culture. So you probably won't see me at a McDonald's or anything like that. Over there, I want to try to get out to as much Chinese things as possible. So if you're into that too, that's what I really like to just experience and immerse myself in. And I want to see the Great Wall. That's like the biggest thing I want. That is pretty big.
Now, my sister suggested you turn the camera to who's thinking.
Okay. Why don't we do that? Hang on just a second.
Adam, stay in front of the camera.
Had a suggestion to turn the camera to who's speaking. We can actually be portable on it. There we go. So that was Mr. Reynolds. Let's see. Here we go. Ms. Wilson, no pressure now.
I'm Beth Wilson. Something that I would like everybody to know, well, same thing. I'm very, very looking forward to experiencing new culture. And I'm not particularly well-traveled yet. I've never left our continent, but I'm pretty excited about going and experiencing everything.
Okay, great. John?
Hi, my sisters are on the other line.
So everybody say hi.
So, my sister, so I'm going, my sister Beth and my sister Bambi are going. And I couldn't find pictures, I was looking for pictures for them on the my phone, I couldn't find it. I'm looking forward to it. I take lots and lots and lots of pictures. I'm warning you now.
Okay, that's good to know in advance, actually. Jared?
I'm Jared Powell, and I don't like my picture being taken.
That's between you and your mother. Okay, we'll try to remember that.
Okay, well, I'm Maddie, and I am a big foodie, so I will probably not be eating, you know, normal food. I'll just go on, find street food that's really, that looks really good, and I'll probably be eating that most of the time.
Yeah, you'll find a lot of that.
Yes.
Yeah. All right.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm extremely quiet, so hopefully I won't get lost in the crowds. So just keep an eye out on me.
Okay. Good advice. All right. Great.
Hi, I'm Priya, and I'm a morning person, so I'm going to be that annoying person that's super happy in the morning.
That's one of the things we're going to talk about. We're going to need that, so that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Thank you.
I'm Jake Clutterbuck, and I'm pretty laid back. So if you just want to chill with someone in China.
So maybe we shouldn't put you and Priya together in the mornings. Got it. Cole?
I'm Cole Shiflett. I don't know if there's anything to say about me. I don't know.
You hug people a lot.
Oh, I hug a lot of people.
Okay. That may make the Chinese people nervous.
It might. So
maybe you just kind of want to play that one by ear a little bit. Okay. Okay. Jack?
I'm Jack Baines, and I'm like really outgoing, so if I come up to you and like start chatting you up about anything, then I'm not like weird or anything. I just talk a lot.
No, that's a good thing, actually. We'll be spending lots of time on buses and planes and in airports and things.
I'm Fisher Oaks, and I'm pretty energetic at night, so sorry if I keep you guys awake.
Okay, we'll be talking about that too.
I'm Annabelle Rhodes, and I sing a lot, and I also like to tap dance a lot. So yeah.
Anywhere, anytime?
Yeah.
Just to whatever tunes in your mind? Okay, that's a good thing. And so I'm Mark Caraway, and I've done this trip before, as I think most of you know. So that's kind of a plus, and maybe not so much a plus in some ways, because I know what we're getting into. And that's a little bit about what we're going to talk about. But I'm also kind of an energetic morning person. And one of the things that we will talk about is just kind of the pace of the trip, what's going to happen on a day-to-day basis, because those things are pretty critical and how we deal with those things, because it's kind of nonstop. So one of the things that happened when I was talking with our EF guy was he sent me a presentation, actually, that he said, I told him we were having this meeting. He said, oh, do you want a presentation? I said, well, I've already got some stuff that I want to talk about, but I didn't have it in a PowerPoint. And he was like all enthusiastic about it. No, you need to have a PowerPoint. So he sent me one. So a lot of it fits what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to kind of back and forth between here and there, but I want to talk about a couple of things. First of all, the trip, and I think everybody knows the itinerary by now, but it's pretty critical because this is different. When I was on my training, we talked a lot about trips. People travel in different ways from different places. Our trip is going to be basically like going to New York, St. Louis, and Atlanta, in terms of geography. So we're going to cover a lot of ground in a relatively short time, and that's going to have a lot to do with kind of how our process goes. One of the things that actually talking to the EF rep today, he said to me that one of the things that you need to know up front is that the internal Chinese flights often get delayed. I didn't experience that in my last trip, but he said that's a pretty regular thing. So he advised just keep calm, carry on. They'll make sure that it works and we get to where we need to go. Couple of things about this. I looked into the itinerary. We're actually staying, the last time that I stayed and did the same trip, we're staying in two of the hotels that I stayed in previously, which is nice because I know the area. And one of the things I'll talk about is, you know, for those of you who frequently want to get out and eat street food and do some things like that, you know, we've got really full days, usually all the way up through dinner. But one of the things I found most rewarding was to go out like into neighborhoods and people were really friendly and really kind. And there's some great neighborhoods close to the hotel. I haven't torn them down a lot since I was last there. One of the things that's happening in Beijing is they have these old, old neighborhoods, very traditional old neighborhoods called hutongs. And they have been, over the years, they keep knocking them down toward new construction. So they're becoming really endangered. And it's kind of it's a very culturally Chinese kind of thing when you're out there. And the hutongs, everybody kind of comes out onto the street at night, brings their tables there. Charcoals, you know, some of them are selling food and some of them are just families having dinner. And you know, when you're walking through, people are really friendly. It's a really interesting place to be. So hopefully we're going to have some opportunities like that. First couple things, flights. You know, I think everybody's pretty aware of the itinerary. But our first flight, when I went nonstop, which was great. They obviously did not set us up for that. We're going to be flying through Toronto. But first flight at 9:30 a.m. And one of the things I have not gotten nailed down yet, for those of you who are interested in transport to the airport, I've not been able to nail anything down. I've contacted a couple of different limo and bus companies, because I haven't gotten a lot back. But I'm going to continue to work on that. And if not that, then we're going to hope to start some kind of a carpool network. I've got a van that can seat 7 or 8 people, for example, and you know, we might be able to do something like that. We will want to get there early. I'm sure everybody's been here, you know, listening to the news over the last few days, in particular about TSA, long lines. You know, good news for us, we're traveling early on a weekday. That's usually not quite so bad as traveling on a weekend. But this will be my 5th international flight in the last 12 months. You know, I can tell you that, you know, if you hit it wrong, it can be a couple of hours before you can get through that whole thing. So we're going to want to make sure that we're there with plenty of time to be able to cover everything. So I'm going to kind of, as I mentioned, I'm going to kind of bounce back and forth between here and there. Let's see, a couple things about the flights, just and our rep reminded me today. You know, they're booking the flights, they're booking them kind of en masse. We've not gotten assigned seats yet. When you get your seats, and particularly for adults that are traveling, if you have interest in doing your own upgrade or something like that, you have that opportunity. You'll have to have that information, this flight information. I was looking at some possibilities with that, and Air Canada wouldn't let me touch it because we didn't have our information on that. So hopefully, as soon as we get the flight information, anybody's looking to do that, they'll have that opportunity. We will travel. Speaking of flights, we will travel as a group in the sense of, you know, going through the airport together, making sure that everybody's staying close, so we know where everybody is through that process, because as you know, it can be kind of crazy. But you know, as far as once we get on the airplane, I have no idea. You know, I don't think they usually seat you in blocks. I think we'll be kind of scattered all over the airport. So we'll kind of figure that out, and you know, from whatever information we get there. If anybody has any questions as I'm going through, you know, just let me know. One of the things that Pat, our guy up in Boston, sent me was a sample itinerary, which looks a lot like the itinerary that we did when I was on this trip before. And I know I've said this before, but I cannot stress it enough. We will be walking a lot. A lot of people, when I did this Rome training trip, had Fitbits, and we were covering in the ballpark of 6 or 7 miles a day. So my very strong suggestion, and I keep going to this, is make sure you got the right kind of footwear. There's not a whole lot that we're going to be doing that's real formal. You know, this is a student trip, and it's meant to be a student trip. So they're expecting, you know, I mean, they take us to some nice restaurants and some fun stuff, but there's nothing that would, you know, like you get thrown out for walking in running shoes. So basically, I'm going to go in a pair of Tevas and a pair of running shoes. That's what I'm going to have. And maybe a pair of sandals. I just flip-flops for knocking around the hotel. But I would, if you're going to wear sandals, I would strongly suggest having something that's a, like a, you know, more protective sandal, like Tevas or something like that. Just, I was on a trip with somebody who was wearing flip-flops and broke their toe just by walking into a thing on the street. And there's a lot of just kind of junk in the street in some places in China. So you want to have, you know, fairly protective. If you're going to have wear open shoes, you want to be protective open shoes. A little bit about the daily itinerary stuff. I'm going to go into their itinerary. We're not going to read all this, but I mean, you can kind of just tell from the, just all of this stuff, there's a lot going on every day. And one of the things is we're going to hit, you know, we're going to go essentially be flying overnight. We're going to get there. We're going to hit the ground running. And like that first day is going to be a drag. And I'm not real susceptible to, what do you call it? Jet lag. Thank you. I'm not real susceptible to jet lag. I am susceptible to long school this. One of the things about that is it really works pretty well. They keep you going through that first day. I mean, you're going to be on a bus somewhere and you're just kind of going like this, and that's fine. You can catch a few naps, catch a few winks or whatever. But it really, you want to push through and be positive and as energetic as much as possible. For those of you about just a note about sleeping on the plane, this is not by way of advice, but just something that I found worked for me. I'd never tried this before, but when I went on the last trip, I tried melatonin. And it worked really well as far as putting me to sleep, although I sleep pretty long planes as it is. So, but I was able to sleep for longer than I normally would. A couple of things about that. Just out of curiosity, and I know I've asked this question before, but how many of y'all, this is going to be your first, like, really long flight and out of the country and to the view they're going? Okay. So if you haven't done this, I've got a product goodie bag. If you haven't done this, I strongly suggest getting a neck pillow, and I like an inflatable one so I can pack it up. Some people like a nice big fuzzy one that they just kind of carry around and stuff in their bag, but I would strongly suggest when you're on an airplane for that long, you want something, you know, and the airplanes are pretty, you know, they're pretty good, but we're on for a long time. So something that will, you know, hold you up and kind of keep you going hold you up so you can sleep okay. That's a pretty strong suggestion. I found that. That's a pretty helpful thing. Once again, on the day-to-day basis, usually what it looks like is we're going to get up, we're going to get on a bus, we're going to go somewhere, we'll see something in the morning, then they'll usually take us to an area. Usually lunch is on our own, but on our own means like we're in a particular area where they maybe have a couple of different options, or sometimes the whole bus will just say, you know, they'll say, look, we've got an option of a restaurant that we can go to. Does everybody want to do that? And they'll just take us to that place. But then we'll go to lunch, and then we'll go to another site in the afternoon. So we are jamming pretty much all the way through. Usually, I think most days you'll get back to the hotel before we do dinner, but not always. So, you know, you just kind of want to think about, you know, one of the things, and EF is really nice to give us these handy-dandy backpacks, so make sure you take these. This would be perfect for, like, just doing your day stuff, making sure you got a bottle of water, making sure maybe you've got a couple of snacky stuff. One of the things I found really easy to find snacky, you know, like small convenience stores close by to kind of re-up and have that kind of stuff. Anything that you feel like you're going to need during the course of the day, you'll want to have some kind of a bag or a man purse or whatever, you know, you want to call it, to take that kind of stuff around. Yeah. I've heard a lot of comments about the man purse thing, so I throw that in. So part of this, you know, just in terms of the tour logistics as well, is we're going to have a tour director. I got it, actually learned his name today, but I forgot it between now and now. But we will know it very well throughout the trip. And really, that tour director is the general for everything that happens. I mean, you know, we're going to be there. We're going to be putty in that person's hand. And just I should note, we will be on, on a bus probably with at least one other group. And possibly more than that, you know, because the buses are, I think, up to 45, 50 people. So they like to combine the groups as much as possible. So, yes, sir.
How many are in our group?
In our group total is 21. So that's all adults and students.
I was making sure you were talking.
It does include me.
No, we have, so we have 15 students in 6 months. Including your sisters. So it's a, you know, it's a nice size group, actually. One of the things that we will do, that we'll kind of work on, and I don't know a lot about, how we want to do it, but depending on where we are, when we go to Shanghai, we go to some of the same places before, there's like shopping areas and stuff, and we can kind of spread it out a little bit. We'll kind of figure out smaller, kind of subgroups, and use some different subgroups, like for just keeping track, so that we're not all stuck together as a one kind of phalanx of people walking around together all the time. There will be lots of opportunities. That said, one of the things is we don't want people going off on their own. One of the things about this is with this itinerary, it's like this all the time. And, it's the people that wander off on their own. Like the other 45 people are waiting on the bus, and it's really embarrassing to be that person who's getting on the bus that everybody else has been waiting for 15 or 20 minutes for. Yeah.
So some of the places that I've gone to, you have to bring your own toilet paper because they don't provide toilet paper. Is that true in China?
Well, as a matter of fact, it's on the agenda.
Okay, I saw that.
I didn't look. It is strongly suggested, as a matter of fact. And toilets in China are variable quality and variable style. So I'm not going to go into a great deal. Because part of the idea of this trip is a journey of discovery. So sometimes that discovery might involve somebody running out of a bathroom screaming,
"I'm not using it."
I've seen that happen. But it is very, it will be advisable. Pat, our guy from Boston, said today, you really want to bring your own toilet paper. And hotels, and restaurants and stuff, no problems. But just if you're out on the street, we're doing, doing like the tour stuff out in the day, sometimes you just don't know what you're about. So okay. It's a good idea to have just on the fact of that. I was more of a little team than
right.
So, yeah, good question. Yeah.
You can repeat the question for COVID.
Yeah, so the question was, do we need to bring our own toilet paper? Yes, and hand sanitizer as well.
So what did you say?
Yeah. No, that's good. I'm glad we got a little question that worked right. And it was good. Toilet paper, we were on. Yeah. So getting there first day, again, it's just going to be that kind of place. The great thing is we see tons and tons of stuff, but it will be, and even Fisher, I think this is even going to wear you out by the end of the day. It's quite possible because, really what happens is a lot of people just go at 7 o'clock and go to bed, and that's it. First night or two may be a little interesting for sleeping, just because I know for myself, I kind of woke up about 3 o'clock in the morning, like, okay, I'm ready to go to work. But it's I think you get in the group pretty quickly, and particularly with the pace that we're going to be on. I mentioned the tour director. Really, with this tour, we will have a tour director that will be with us through the entire trip. We'll go from place to place. And then we'll have local guides. And I'll talk a little bit about that because that affects us in a couple of ways. But it's one of the neat things is the local guides are, in my experience, both on the China trip and then our Rome training trip, is that they're awesome. They're really good. They have a lot of inside knowledge. So that's going to be kind of a fun piece of that. So getting down to some essential details here. First of all, I put some links in here. If you hadn't checked those out, it's a good idea to go to those. A lot of the things that we've covered and I've talked about in my previous thing. But getting into some of this, I'm going to need some of this paperwork ahead of time. And I mentioned specifically passports. So you have your passports and you have your visa, which very few people actually have Chinese visas in their passports. What you'll need to do is make sure that you have multiple copies of the front page of your passport, the page that has your picture in it and your passport number, and the visa page. And when I say multiple copies, here's what you're going to need those for. You need to give me one of each of those pages so that I have them in case something comes up. Your passport gets lost or stolen or read later or something. You'll want to have one with you if possible in your wallet or in your luggage or somewhere just for the same reasons. It's just nice to have redundancy. And you'll want to leave one home with whoever your emergency contact is. So in case there's an issue where we have to communicate with that person. All that information is there. So three copies of each of those sections of your passport. And I'll be collecting those up before we get to the actual trip day. Along with that, EF has a health and medical profile.
and that was linked in here. And you will need to complete that, and I'll need to have a copy of that. You'll need to leave a copy of that also with your emergency contact. And particularly food allergies, you know, one of the things that, and that's something I'm going to ask for ahead of time, the tour director or the tour person up in Boston said they really need to know about serious food allergies ahead of time so that they can make any decisions about restaurants or places that we're going to go to eat. So please make sure you're letting us know about that. Any medications? I've had some questions about, will I be dispensing medications? I will not be dispensing medications. That is something everybody is that's going on the tour, I think, is able to kind of cover that, but I do need to know about that. So please make sure that's a part of that medical record as well. So getting into some of the serious stuff, and that is, and serious stuff, I mean, packing and getting ready for this trip. So I actually brought, what I like to use for my suitcase, put stuff all that. A couple things about this. I mean, this is a carry-on suitcase. Make sure that you know sizes for a carry-on suitcase. And I actually put them into the agenda here. So it's pardon?
They're pretty small for carry-on.
Yeah. Well, actually, Air Canada, which is our flight, actually are slightly smaller than these by half an inch. But
I've been running around with a tape measure at every flight.
I think we'd be able to get away with that. But I have that. I mentioned this is going to be our fifth international flight this year. I have not checked the bag in any of those flights. I've put, even in the wintertime, I'm able to get everything in this bag. And a couple of things about this. I know there's various styles. I have one of those carry-ons that has wheels on the bottom, like backpack style. But it's something where if you've got a possibility of being able to expand and use compression straps, that's a big, a nice thing like this. You know, once I get everything there, I can kind of ratchet it down. The other piece about carry-ons is weight. And the only time I've not been allowed to take a carry-on, any time that it's been, no, you can't use that as a carry-on, you're going to have to check that, has not been because of size, it's been because of weight, which really ticked me off because it's like they just sit there and look at it and go, that's too heavy. But it was. They weighed it and it was. So you want to watch that as well. So a couple of things along with that. I just brought a couple of different props here that I wanted to share. And part of that is the kind of stuff that I take for this trip. It is going to be
camera.
Okay, guys, we're getting over. So a couple of things that I take. I take a lot of this kind of stuff, which is, this is a fishing shirt, but it's just really lightweight ripstop nylon. Anything you can pack like that. I'm going to tell you, you're not going to need a lot of long pants. You're not going to need, yeah, Matt.
Are shorts acceptable, James?
They are. I wouldn't go super short.
Right.
But, I'd go, nice shorts, okay. And they're used to tourists. I mean, we're all the places we're going to are tourist places. Okay. So this is, I mean, part of the reason I dress like this is how I'm going to be dressed for most of my days, the time that we're gone. I would think about it. We are definitely, and I think I mentioned this in my last broadcast, we're going to have access to laundry. So you don't need to have a different item every day. Think about mix and matching. Bring stuff that you can rinse in a sink and dry out overnight. That's really easy to do. But I will, in doing this and in traveling a lot, in a lot of different situations, I always find that easy to overpack. The people who have overpacked really regret it by the end of the trip. So think in terms of, again, what I'm going to do, I'm going to wear my running shoes because that's going to be my only real pair of shoes that I'm going to have. I have my sandals and my flip-flops and my bag. That's going to be about it for shoes. And then I'm going to have most everything is going to be like this style of clothing. The other thing that I don't know if you've used these or not, but compression bags makes it really easy to fit a lot of stuff in. You just put stuff in into them. Some of them have a vacuum thing where you can actually vacuum the air out. Some of them, like this, you just roll it up and squeeze all the air out, and it will get a lot of a pile of like this kind of stuff down to the size of a Pringles can. So you can get a lot of that. Amazon. Just compression bags for luggage. Yeah, these things are really good for this kind of stuff. But I'm not saying everybody needs to go out and buy a new wardrobe, but for me, and this
Just another thing about this shirt, and it's a long sleeve shirt. I'm going to a place that's going to be 100 degrees. But here's what I found, like in places like in Beijing, Tiananmen Square, or in Xi'an's out in the middle of the desert, in the middle of the country. It is blazing, and I mean blazing like sun blazing hot. So this was really nice to actually have a cool but long sleeve thing on. I was really glad that I had this one in Xi'an, because I found it really, really hot, and also really hot. I would also suggest bringing lightweight hats as well for that stuff. So a couple of things as far as recommended items. When I was there before, it rained for 2 days straight in Beijing. I would suggest really tiny umbrellas, or if you do like I did last time and completely forget your umbrella, which I generally don't tend to travel with one, and then just buy one there. I bought a Chinese umbrella off the street for $2. I still have it. I still use it. And every time I use it, I think about my trip to China. So, you know, you go that way. You know, you will find, if it's raining, you're going to find 1,000 people selling umbrellas. So if you don't want to pack one, you can just kind of go that way. And you can think about that for some of just what you would think of like basic necessity items. A lot of that stuff is, you know, things like this would be there. Ponchos, if you want those. I do like to bring a lightweight rain jacket with me just in case. Had some questions about, and I talked a little bit about this, but about transformers and converters, right? This is a converter. I'm not taking it. I just usually use a transformer, because the only thing I'm going to be plugging in, quite honestly, is going to be my iPad or my iPhone to charge, and they will charge off the 220. But I've seen people like bring like bricks of electrical transformation devices. You really don't need to carry a 5-pound electrical transformation device. So I think that's probably getting a little too much. But one of the things too, and this is something where maybe Mr. Reynolds with our website is we might think about share items, for people that want to charge different things. And I mentioned this before, one of the big recommendations would be hair dryers. Share, like, not everybody packing up their own separate hair dryers, maybe having a couple of you. Most of the hotels have them built in. As a matter of fact, they probably all of them, but if you're concerned about that, maybe a couple of people bring portables and they'll be able to share this. So we can start some communication going on that. You can just go out.
Well, I can cut my hair.
It's not a good thing. So a couple other things. I always bring, this is just my own personal recommendation, a travel towel. And it's just, sometimes you just never know what the condition of the linens and things, and that it just comes in handy. Actually, I put this in my day pack when I'm carrying stuff around, because I found it kind of useful in some different places. If anybody's used these noise canceling headphones, really good for the flight. They can be real expensive and they can be not so expensive. These are not very expensive. These are JVCs, another thing you can get from Amazon. But they just kind of, they've got a filter on, a noise filter on them. You flip the switch, they have a little battery, you flip the switch, and it just cuts out about 60% of the jet noise right there. So, and makes things a little nicer. So, sharing this kind of stuff. I think that's mostly it. The other thing that I forgot to pack up was, I always use a passport wallet that's a neck style passport wallet. I strongly recommend something like that, not just putting passports in pants pockets, but having something that is attached to you in another way, whether it's a belt or a neck carry thing. Those, you just want to have that in a safe place. That's pretty good. That's a pretty critical item for you. Also related to that, money, and I've been getting a lot of questions about how much to bring. I was looking back because I was curious to what EF said about that. They say $50, and $50 worth of currency. We'll be in Dallas, we'll actually be in Toronto for several hours. There'll be plenty of opportunities to change money. The airport rates, as you probably know, are terrible. So you don't want to change a ton of money. You don't want to do hundreds and hundreds of dollars at the airport, because you'll get the worst rates going. Really, the best way to get money is to use your bank card or your Visa card, Visa or other credit card. But it is absolutely critical. And I've seen people not do this and seen really suffer for it. You absolutely have to let them know when and where you're going. Because if a charge pops up on your credit card or your debit card from Beijing, China, they're going to say, no, that's not where you usually do business.
And so you want to make sure that you've gotten that in there. And my advice, I've had some people, I've known some people who have gone in online and set up travel plans on their cards and not have it registered. I always find that. So I always just call and say, just let me know. Yeah.
Well, one thing also, they, when last time I flew, Toronto too. Let them know you're going to Toronto in case you buy into
Cover. Thing. Yeah, I'll be in Toronto on this day and then the rest of the trip will be in China. That's good advice. Yeah, I've had that. Seen that.
Debit cards work fine.
Debit cards are not as good as credit cards. It kind of depends on where you go. I mean, most people, I don't use a debit card. I only use it as a bank card, you know. And usually you can get like an ATM machine, you'll be able to get cash. Whether it's accepted as a card for transactions, that seems to be a little bit more of an issue with debit cards. I didn't find any problems with the Visa card. Yeah.
Something else you can do is you can buy like refillable cards where you just put money onto the card. Doesn't that work?
Not in China. Not well. And it's not that they don't work, but they don't work well in China. A lot of places do not accept those. So actually, I was specifically, I'm glad you got that because that was my next point. I was specifically warned about that by our agent in Boston to make sure people know don't do a prepaid card because you may find it not taken or not accepted in places there. So they're better off with credit card and then debit card, a bank card for your ATM. And again, let your bank know about that. Tipping, and this is on, this actually is on the EF thing. This is a big deal, and it's a big deal in the sense that there's a lot, the folks that are working there are doing that. I'm trying to find it. There we go. Are doing that. This is a part of their living, a big part of their living. Oh, excuse me. So usually these are the expected rates. This is something that I will be collecting ahead of time. We actually are going to apply the money that has been used for fundraising for everybody to participate in that. It will be applied on a percentage basis on how much time they put in. So I've got kind of all that on a spreadsheet. And we're actually in pretty good shape on that. And for anybody that has put in more hours, and then they'll get some of that as walk around money. So that'll be getting out to you in the next couple of weeks as soon as we can get through the end of the school year. But just, I want y'all to be aware, because this is something I'm gonna need to do ahead of time. Usually what I was advised by EF was go ahead and collect the tips ahead of time for the tour guide and for the driver, because those are like known quantities. And then the local guides, we'll take care of that as we go. So I know it's another expense, but it's seeing the level of service that we get to these folks, I think it's a legitimate expense as well. A couple of things I wanted to hit on here. I mentioned about meals, but just to review, I found that they say that meals are usually cereal, bread, juice, coffee, tea. I found that at least in the hotels we were staying, it was a little bit more than that, which was a good thing, kind of a good start to the day. Again, lunches were on our own for the most part and pretty available. The dinners were fantastic. We kind of went up. They like to set you up with, like, the Peking Duck restaurant, or they have different places they like to kind of take us to, for dinner that kind of highlight like the regional cuisine, things like that. So no problems on that. But I will say, don't drink the water. This is one you want to make sure that you're getting bottled water. So one of the things I think somewhere I saw, oh yeah, get your own collapsible water jug so you can fill it at the hotel and take it with you all day. Just get bottled water. And it's part of, and for brushing your teeth, yeah, that's when a lot of folks forget about that. The hotels are pretty good, but they are, the rooms are definitely smaller than we're used to in the United States, and it's just different. A lot of the layouts and things like that. So, if you walk in and you go, well, this doesn't look like a Holiday Inn, it's not going to do. But, the other thing about it, and that they mentioned on here, Wi-Fi, and I think I've mentioned this, it's really spotty as far as what you have there. So we'll have some Blue Ridge hotspots and things for folks that, for critical needs and things like that, not for watching videos, but we've got to pay for all that data. But we'll have stuff there that will be available. So,
tip money, we give you 78 US dollars, right?
Yes. Yeah. And that actually brings up a good point.
You will find, I would say it would be a good idea to bring, make sure that you do bring some American cash, not just for exchanging, because a lot of people take, I don't know if you're aware, but the Chinese currency is set, the exchange rate is set by the government, but a lot of people will accept dollars at a better rate than what you would get on the exchange market. So sometimes if you're out shopping, particularly in kind of like markets and stuff where you've got, you know, kind of stalls and things, you know, people will be really happy. Like, you'll negotiate a price, and you need to, the other thing is you need to make sure, are we talking about dollars? Are we talking about yen, the Chinese currency, when you're negotiating prices? Because you'll think you're talking about yuan, and you know, which is a lot lower than a dollar, and they'll say, no, we want dollars, you know. So make sure that you're being clear about that, like when you're negotiating about stuff. It is a good idea to have some small bills, American bills, because you'll find that would be really useful for you. Actually, now that I think about it, we can do equivalency for the tips. It doesn't have to be dollars. You know, I remember to some people that give it over in Chinese when I said before. The roommate stuff, I really don't have anything to do with that, and I've had a couple of questions about it. I don't really know much about the process. I think we're past the point of being able to do a whole lot with the roommate situation, but I think there's also a little bit of chance for flexibility within, you know, trips if people want to make some decisions about that. We'll just need to know who's where. That's the main thing. That's the big deal. So knowing who's where each night, we don't lose anybody.
Is that all figured out ahead of time?
Oh yeah. It's EF does all that. That's why I say I really don't know much about that. They just basically tell you, here's your room. And you know that they'll have all of that stuff. Right? That's my understanding. This is one of their slides. Is anybody doing the Global Travel Protection Plan? Okay. I mean, they advised doing it. I don't think I did, or I didn't do that. We'd be tough because yours haven't been paid. Anyway, if you have it, just make sure that you have all the information that goes with that, so that you know what you have. But I think, you know, basically what I found is they're pretty good covering most everything, but this is a good, you know, just a little extra insurance policy that they like to advise. Last couple things here, and I'm getting into, about shopping. I did want to talk about shopping. One of the things that happens here that I found is they take us to a couple of different places to show us some things where they put a real hard sell. And one is like in Beijing, there's an old freshwater pearl factory. And you know, and then you go in and you see how they seed the pearls and they do all, and it's really neat and stuff. But then it's like, buy stuff from us, you know, and then you're kind of captive there for about half an hour. Don't feel obligated to buy stuff. We went to a pearl place. There's not a lot of that happens. Most of the time, it's usually when we go to a shopping area and it's kind of turned loose. It's about shopping. But a couple of times, there are definitely some places you go. And it's really neat to see. I mean, the pearl place was really, it was really educational. We saw silk being made. But then you're in the silk shop for about 40 minutes, kind of going, I really don't want to buy much silk, you know, trying to figure that out. So, you know, just know ahead of time that you don't need to feel pressured for anything like that if we end up in one of those places. Student expectations, I wouldn't be taking you guys if I didn't think everything was going to be good, but I got to say, and I'm going to say this, you know, as somebody who's had to make many hard decisions about students over the years, and not just in this role, you know, as a principal and assistant principal, you know, I've seen a lot of good kids over the years and you know, put a lot of kids in situations and sometimes had to deal with some tough stuff. I just need to know and need all of you to know that we're going to be really serious about certain things. One is no going out alone. I mean, no going out of the hotel on your own. We're going to have enough adults that we'll be able to have groups. As I said, I really like going out into the neighborhoods at night. It's a fun and rewarding thing as long as we're doing it, you know, in groups. Somebody knows, you know, you have a group together, and I'm talking about groups with an adult. When you're going out from the hotel, that's going to be the law of the land, non-negotiable, okay? We'll be in places where there will be, you know, like when we're out on a day and go to, there's certain areas that will be, hey, everybody go out, come back to here. That's fine. There's some really good places that are structured that way.
but you know, around hotels and nights and stuff, that's not going to be happening. The other thing is there will be curfews, and so that's, you know, no traffic between hotel rooms. We'll be with other groups, you know, and if you, you know, meet and make friends, that's a wonderful thing. That's part of what you're going for, but you don't want that to extend into 3 o'clock in the morning chasing people around the hotel. So that's going to be an absolute non-negotiable. I'm not expecting any of this, but I got to say, drugs and alcohol, absolutely verboten. And as I say, you know, so here we are in China. The only kind of decision we can make in a situation where it gets bad is how to get you home. And that's not going to be pretty if it were to happen. I don't expect that. But, you know, I think in some places, and I know with some trips, and some of what I've heard from people who've taken other, taken kids on trips to other countries, particularly where, now I'm not even sure what the drinking ages are in China, but I'm going to just presume that they're 21, and that's how we're going to operate, because, you know, that's what we're going to do. Sorry, you can't do it in Charlottesville, you can't do it in Shanghai, okay? At least legally. I'm talking about Charlottesville. Shanghai, whether legal or not, just, you know, just for this trip, we're there to experience and to see and to do some new things. But and it's not a, you know, culturally, I don't think it's as inviting in that respect as some of the other countries that students go to, but, you know, or as, you know, it's not something you walk out and see a lot of that stuff going on, but I just need to make sure that everybody's absolutely clear on that. You know, we'll have contacts, you know, the last thing anybody wants to do is try to, is to have to put somebody on a plane or have to put somebody on house arrest or whatever it has to be. And I don't expect it. We wouldn't be going if I thought there was really any level of risk on this. But yeah, needs to be said. So enough said on that. And, I'm going to be talking with adults after this meeting, so that part I just wanted to make sure that was on there. I did have questions about, and it came up a little bit, actually a couple of folks, Johnny, a couple of folks had asked about taking masks. It is, you know, you've heard a lot about the pollution. There is a lot of pollution. I didn't see that many people with masks. You see it. I didn't feel the need to do that. I didn't walk around with Reese and Hack. I went for runs most mornings that I was there, and didn't seem to run into too many problems. I think out of the destinations going to Beijing was probably the worst in terms of just out and out air pollution. But Shanghai's pretty stuffy too. Shanghai's like 20 million people, and it's, when I was there, it was 105 degrees and 99% humidity. It is a, you know, it's a close kind of place. But I didn't see anybody having issues. We had people who were asthmatic on the trip that I was there. Nobody wore masks, and we didn't have any problems with that. So, what other questions do you guys have about?
What about sunscreen?
Sunscreen, it would be good to have a small, you know, anything that you take is going to have to be in a small tube because of, you know, TSA stuff or traveling. But yeah, I think it's a good idea to have because, you know, there are some places where, yeah, particularly for the more red complexion. not pointing at anybody, Cole. But yeah, that's I think that would be a really good thing to have. You know, again, not too many places. We'll be kind of traveling and undercover a lot of times, but, you know, like in Jian, where we go to the Terracotta Warriors, it's a big open plaza. We're kind of outside, and it's sort of like a, you know, the sun just beats right down. That's it.
We'll be able to buy razors in China because we can't take it on the plane.
I would say, you know, I should have liked it, razor, so I don't, you know, I haven't really come across that problem, but I don't think you're going to have any problem finding any kind of basic toiletry stuff like that. Actually, a lot of it's available in the hotels right there. And then every place that we stay is close to shopping areas. And there's a lot of small market kind of places, you know, just, you know, just like little hole in the wall marts and so on, that they have a lot of stuff. So, yeah.
Close to what he was asking. So we'd be able to, like, within China, like the Chinese flights, if I like go out and I buy, like, you know, shampoo and conditioner in a larger bottle, will I be able to take them on those planes?
Probably not. I think they go with the same rules, you know, a little and a half. Yeah, they're a little, as a matter of fact, I mean, I saw a couple of things like, you know, usually, like, if you're, once you're in the security area in the U.S., you can buy a bottle of water and take it on the plane, and we'll let you down. Okay. I saw a bunch of people have dumped it on. You know, having leave their water bottles and stuff like that. And they're pretty, you know, it's different. And so some things you kind of go, wow, okay, then, you know, I don't think we had to take our shoes off for the internal flights, that kind of stuff. But then some things are really hard for them. So I wouldn't bet on it. And our tour, but I will tell you, our tour guide will be great, you know, be a great resource for that. And, you know, one of the things, you know, the first day, like, you get there, great. Yeah.
We are really limited. For someone who needs hand sanitizer, saline solution, shampoo, thinking mostly the girls, you know, I've already got hers packed up, and it's not nearly enough that she's going to need for the entire week.
Right. But I think you're, you know, I think you can buy small bits.
Oh, yeah. I bought a little saline solution, but it doesn't last very long. Yeah. Maybe.
What else?
It all has to fit in a
port-sized
bag, right?
Yeah. Right. It does, yes. And that's, they want to see it, you know, so you can hold it up. You know, it needs to be in a plastic bag that they can see through and see all that stuff like that. Yeah. Hopefully they'll have the TSA stuff straightened out. You know, they're trying to hire a few more folks between now and then. Goodness me. Yes, ma'am.
I think originally I heard that you wanted the people at the airport by 9, like, and 90 minutes beforehand, are you adjusting
that?
No,
I'm saying
3 hours.
2.5 to 3 hours. I would say that we're going to have a meeting point probably at 7 o'clock at the airport.
Okay.
That's, you know, I've been doing 2.5 hours for international flights all this year, and
yeah,
that's been pretty good. Yeah. Been pretty good.
Yeah, we flew out. You're fine on the national, that goes.
Yeah. Anything else?
What is it precisely about the water in the cesspool?
I'm not sure.
I mean, no pools?
Generally, it's so in a lot of water, like, they don't have the same, like cleaning systems, because, like, if you go to South America, they have cleaning systems, but you still can't drink the water because it will make you very sick. So there are just different, like, I don't say chemicals, but they have different, like, ways of treating the water to make it safe, and our bodies aren't adjusted to it at all. That's why.
I would presume, but I don't remember seeing it. So, I mean, our hotels, you know, I actually brushed my teeth with it and didn't have any problems at all, but, I knew some people who were, you know, a lot of people just don't want to take chances, and it's a good thing when you're traveling, but spend a couple of days with a, you know, parasite or something like that. So,
but there's no reason I have to shower.
No worries about any of that.
We went to the travel clinic at UVA, and they suggested actually just take that from the lobby, just take it. And they also gave us a prescription already for the travel diary medicine.
Oh.
So that we can have it with us, just in case.
Yes, I mean, we need to pack, like you said, whatever kind of medication they need, like, you know, Benadryl or like the generic medications they might need, like Tylenol. Should everybody pack their own Tylenol and all there? I mean,
it's available, but it wouldn't be a bad idea to have some, you know.
I say for Rip, you know, stop and make a little trip. So
yeah, I would say yeah. So, and that's, you know, part of that daily travel bag stuff. That would be, you know, have a little pack of anything like that. You think, you know, just even something like a couple of Band-Aids is helpful to have, you know, just if you need them. No, I think that's probably a good idea.
Most.
Yeah, and I'll do all with all the walking. Yeah.
Socks.
That's a good suggestion.
This is kind of something that was used in the but are there any other immunizations other than like typhoid and polio that we're supposed to be getting?
There's no requirement.
Right. I mean, yeah.
Not that I'm aware. Double check. And here's one thing I would suggest is going back to your EF accounts and your VF sites and just going through the, you know, the different stuff that I've linked here. I haven't had a chance to go through it all the time. I was kind of putting together some of the thoughts I got from the training that I did. You know, some of them I shared, you know, fair play, but you know, just kind of going through and getting a little bit more information on some of those items. But there's a lot of information on the VF site. And so it might be worthwhile checking in on some of that. But as far as vaccine, you know, nothing that I've heard of. Nobody asked me about shots. I was just in Thailand, you know, a month and a half ago, and no issues there either. So, all right, catch you next.
All right. Actually, I think that's pretty much us. We're going to be around. We're going to make a quick phone call with your sisters and a quick phone conference with adults. And,
So, Beth and Jerry and you are the three chaperones.
We're the official PR.
So you are the three. I know Joni's sister, but she's not a chaperone.
Not there. Don't ask me for money.
No. Okay.
Don't ask me for money either. Please. But thanks again. Again, getting really excited. I'll stay, try to be in touch as I continue working on potential for a ride to the airport and any other information that comes down the pipe. But our guy today, hey, I had a phone conference with our guy today. We seemed to feel like we've covered pretty much everything we need to cover with this agenda. So that was a good thing to hear. So looking forward to it. Thank you guys. And make sure you take your backpack. We have a couple of other things. If anybody wants, did y'all get the, luggage tags? And then we do have one of the things that we'll hand these out when we get to the airport is bracelets if anybody wants with emergency numbers, or if you have another place to put EF emergency numbers, you can do that. So, but we'll get that stuff squared away when we get to the airport. So I will definitely be in touch over the next couple of weeks as we get closer. Thanks a lot. Thanks for coming out. We'll be calling you in a minute, ladies.
Mark, I can print this out.
Uh-huh.
And